you opening your Bibles to the book of 2 Peter again. 2 Peter. Last week, we focused our attention on Peter's words, detailed description of false teachers. We labeled the sermon or called it the anatomy of a false teacher, and rightly so. He gives us a lot of information within that particular chapter about the way about false teachers. We established, first of all, that false teachers are indeed real, that they exist. It's not just simply something that paranoid people make up. False teachers exist. They existed then, they exist now. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. But we also talked about how Peter discusses the way that they work. You remember back in chapter 2 and verse 1 that they had secretly brought in destructive heresies, you know. So they're not exactly waving a flag. They're coming in secretly and working alongside and bringing in their false teaching. Not only do they work that way, we talked about what they teach. You remember that in verse 1 that they deny Christ, the master who bought them is the language that Peter uses. And he talks about other things. I'm not going to give you the whole lesson again, so you'll have to go back and watch last week if you didn't get that. But by way of introduction, we're familiarizing ourselves or reminding ourselves what we looked at last week. We also talked about why they do what they do. And if you remember looking back at verse 3 of chapter 2, that one of the things that they do is to exploit you. They exploit people. They exploit their brethren because of their greed. Right? They don't care that it's gone up. They don't care what it does to you, if it embarrasses you, harms you, costs your soul. They're out for number one, and they are number one in their mind. And so that's why they do what they do. The picture that the Holy Spirit gives of a false teacher through the Apostle Peter was not a pretty picture, was it? Not at all. And in fact, I would say, in some regards, it is actually a grotesque picture. I don't choose that word by mistake. When you look at the end of chapter 2 and you notice verses 20 through 22 and how he pictures the one who has escaped. You know, remember earlier in the chapter he talked about those who had barely escaped. We mentioned new converts and those who were weak. These people are ones who had escaped. And he says, if you go back into the world after you have escaped, right? Well, what's the picture? And he recites a proverb, part of a proverb, about a pig that had been washed going back to lay in the mud. But then the other picture there, that one that just sort of churns the stomach, doesn't it? A dog who comes and vomits and then steps away and then comes back to eat that same vomit. Now, that's, if you got a weak stomach, don't rush out for donuts right now. But that's a very gruesome picture. It's a grotesque picture. And don't think that the Holy Spirit used that language through Peter by mistake. He's trying to paint a very clear picture of the false teacher and the consequences of following the false teacher. And that's why Peter's writing this, is to warn brethren, don't do this. Don't go back to the way the world is. Don't listen to these individuals. And so we've been warned, right? We've been warned about them, and in this very clear picture. And we've also been told how not to be pulled in by them. Now, how is it that we're not pulled in by them? I wish I was in class and I could run up and down here. But you remember the way that we're told, right, how not to be pulled in by false teachers. You go back to chapter 1, right? In chapter 1, where Peter says to add these things to your faith and build upon your faith. And so you have moral excellence and you have knowledge and you have self-control, right? Perseverance, godliness, all these things. And he says if you do these things, number one, you're not going to be useless. You're going to be fruitful in the kingdom. Okay? And you're also going to make sure that you keep your calling and election sure. I like the way the NIV says it, that you're going to keep your secure position, okay, if you do these things. This is the way that we combat the false teacher. This is the way that we make sure that we don't get pulled into it. All right? Now, having known all those things and seen all those things, maybe you're like me and you ask some questions. Are we always going to have to deal with false teachers? They make me tired, you know? They make my, I hate it because they make my brain hurt sometimes, right? And the way I have to think to try to answer or deal with, when it's so much easier for me just to look at the book and say, this is what it says, and I can go live it. But false teachers, you know, am I going to have to keep dealing with this the rest of my life? Are we as the church going to have to keep dealing with it? And let me ask you this important question. Are they going to get away with it? Right? Are these folks going to keep doing what they're doing it over and over and over and over? And are they going to get away with it? And is there ever going to be a time that I can quit doing what John says, or what the language he used there in 1 John 4:1, where I don't have to test or try, put to the test, if you will, the spirits, because many false teachers have gone out into the world? Is that ever going to come to an end? I want to answer those questions this morning. And it's sort of a segue into what I want to do over the next few weeks. But let's deal with these questions, okay? I hope that last week you took advantage of the email that was sent out. If you're not on the church's email list, okay, Justin, sit down here at the front afterwards, drop her your email. I sent out some exercises last week of comparing 2 Peter chapter 2 alongside with the book of Jude. I hope that you did that. It's a very insightful exercise to help you see even more than what Peter is saying here, because I don't have time to do both. I also sent out an exercise that said compare 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 2 and 3 along with, that is, the way the false teacher is with 2 Peter chapter 1 to show the contrast between the two. And you can download those and do that exercise. I hope that you did those things, because it certainly will help you with this text. And if you didn't, they're still there. The email's still there. The exercise is still there. Download them. Do them this week. I think they'll help you over the next few weeks as we take a look at a particular subject as we move on. But we think about these false teachers. Are they always going to be here? Short answer, yeah. Right? We go back to chapter 2 and verse 1. Chapter 2 and verse 1, Peter says, but false prophets also arose among the people. Now, you recall from our lesson last week, we're talking about the fact that God sent prophets under the Old Testament. And it seems almost as soon as he sent prophets, his prophets under the Old Testament, there were false prophets to arise. And there were always false teachers and always false prophets all throughout the Old Testament, right? But we get to the New Testament. And, of course, Peter is obviously warning here the fact that in the same verse, there were false prophets among the people, just as there will also be false teachers among you, right? And so, several thousand years after these false teachers and false prophets of the Old Testament were there, Peter is telling the church, and really the infant church, you know, the church had only been in existence for about 30 years, 35 years at this point, there's going to be false teachers among you, right? And Peter recognized that after he died, there would be false teachers there. When you go back to verses 13 through 15 of chapter 1, you remember the one thing that Peter said when he was talking about those virtues in verses 5 through 7. He says, as long as I'm alive, I'm going to remind you of these things, and I'm going to basically do it so much that even after I die, which is imminent, after I die, you'll be able to recall these things. Why would that be necessary if the false teachers were just all of a sudden going to stop? Just isn't going to happen, right? And so Peter recognizes these things are going to continue on even after I'm not here. And on they will go. In fact, if you look, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3, notice at the beginning of the verse, know this first of all, that in the last days, mockers will come with their mocking, following after their own lusts. And so these mockers are the same false teachers that he's talking about, right? Same, just a different name. And this is showing part of their character in this aspect of their character. They are mocking that which the Lord said is going to happen, right? We'll talk about the verse a little bit more in a minute. Now, this phrase, last days, okay? If you're unfamiliar with biblical language, we need to understand that this phrase, last days, if I hear that I'm in the last days of something, in my mind, because I'm a I don't want to say middle age yet. I'm not there. I'm a young man in American culture, right? And if I use this phrase, last days, I'm thinking, when I'm saying I'm in the last days of high school, let me tell you what, I was down to the end. And that was coming quick, right? So we think about things with this term because of the way we're brought up. But in biblical language, when we're talking about last days, we're referring actually to a dispensation of time, a period of time, right? And we're not really talking about just a few days. We're talking about a period of time. And how long that period of time is, we don't know. And that's part of what's coming in the next few weeks, okay? But you remember back in Acts chapter 2, where Peter preaches the first gospel sermon, and of course the Holy Spirit had come, and he says that this is what the prophet Joel spoke about, that in the last days these different things would happen. And so we understand then that when the church began on the day of Pentecost, ushered in by the Holy Spirit, this is really when the last days began. But we're 2,000 years removed from that, aren't we? But we're still in that same period of the last days. So don't make the mistake of thinking that we're just talking about a few days. We're talking about an indeterminate period of time, the end of which only God knows. It began in Acts chapter 2, okay? So, these people, of course, as we're talking about this last days, we understand we're 2,000 years removed from this, and do we still have false teachers today? Yeah. I mean, it's just as prevalent now, right, as it was then, if not even more so, because of the way that we communicate with each other and are bombarded in the media. So here's the thing that we need to understand. False teachers are always going to be here, okay? While we're alive, if the Lord doesn't come back first, false teachers are going to be a part of life. And understand again, we're not talking about outside in the world. We're talking about these here in particular in context within the church. We should expect that the world is full of false teachers, okay? We don't come to worship and become part of the body of Christ and come expecting that false teachers are going to be there, but we need to understand that will be, okay? The Holy Spirit, through Peter and others, warned us that there will be. So, again, as we mentioned last week, we don't want to be cynical, looking at everyone being a false teacher, nor do we want to be naive. We want to be in the middle, right? Be people of the book, listen to what people have to say, give them the benefit of the doubt, right? Those are all Christian principles that we need to do, but we need to know they do exist. Now, the question that a lot of us want to get to is, and that is, are they going to get away with it? I got to tell you, when I was a younger preacher, I felt like it was my sole duty to try to right every wrong. Right? Any of you feel like that when you were younger? In every aspect of life. If I felt like a local politician or a president were a problem, then I would spend a lot of time writing, spend a lot of time on the phone. Okay? And if something happened within the church, I felt like it was my duty to bring it front and center and confront it and fix it, you know, even if there really wasn't something there as bad as a youngster thought it was. Now, as I've grown in life, and I hope this is the case with you, the way that I came to find some peace and to focus more on the body of Christ and teaching and living the Christian Christian life was when I came to realize that Sean doesn't have the power to right every wrong. I can't fix it. I can't make it right. I can't, in the world, I especially can't fix the world. I can't do it. And here's the thing. God doesn't expect me to do it, does he? He's given me a task. He's given all Christians a task. And so a lot of times, though, you and I, we lose focus with that task, right? And we take our eyes off the prize and we start looking out into the world and we start looking at things that are that we see are injustices and we want to fix them and we want to be part of that and all that kind of thing. But let me say this, friends, if you are going to look for justice in this life, in the world, you're going to live a life of high anxiety, of great disappointment. Right? Because we live in the world of what? The unjust. There's not going to be justice in this world. Now, does it bother us? It should bother us because we want to be the people who are following the Lord and we want to see justice. In fact, you remember, I think it's Revelation chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. You remember those departed saints who had lost their life for the cause of Christ? And in the altar, they're crying up to God, "How long, O Lord?" Waiting for justice, right? But even they recognized, even though they gave their life for Christ, justice wasn't theirs. They weren't going to be the ones bringing justice. We're a whole lot better off. Your life will be so much more calm and peaceful if we leave the justice aspect to God. Right? I can't fix it. And so it relieves me of a great burden to say, you know what? I'm going to do what the Lord says to do. I'm going to do what I can to take as many people to heaven as I possibly can. And even at that, I'm not responsible for if they obey. Again, another blessing. We put that strain on ourselves sometimes, right? We say, I've never baptized anybody. Well, that's not really what God wants us to do. He wants us to sow the seed. And we hope that we sow the seed in good hearts and they do obey the gospel and they do go to heaven. But am I responsible for their obedience? I'm not. Responsible to sow the seed. Let's leave the justice to God. Okay? Don't look for justice in this life because it's simply not going to happen. Now, that being said, let me ask you this. Are they going to get away with it? Huh? We can say for sure that they are not. Remember at the end of verse 1, chapter 2? Bringing swift destruction upon themselves. Now look, when he says they bring swift destruction upon themselves, I think we got language here that's very similar to what we see in chapter 3. We think swift as being, okay, drop the gavel, walk out the door and get zapped, right? And in our terms, that would be swift. But when we get over to chapter 3 and he says, one day with the Lord is 1,000 days and 1,000 days is one day, he's explaining the fact that God's timetable, God's not on a timetable like you and me. And so he's not slack concerning or slow concerning his promise like we, you and me, count slowness. Okay? So swift destruction is the word that is described for what they will face. Go down to verse 4, chapter 2. Notice what he says. If God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell and committed them to pits of darkness reserved for judgment. Okay, so we've got angels, right? He's laying this truth out very clearly, what's going to happen to the false teacher. And he did not spare the ancient world. At the end, he says, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly. And if he condemned, verse 6, the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to destruction by reducing them to ashes, having made them an example to those who would live ungodly lives thereafter. And so here's what you see here. God didn't spare angels when they sinned. And if you're looking for sort of a connection from here to the Old Testament, I think what you're looking at, beginning in verse 4, is a connection with Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And then he goes from those angels that sinned, I think sons of God there in Genesis chapter 6, verse 2, what he's talking about. He goes down to Noah, further in the chapter, Genesis chapter 6. And then he moves on to Genesis chapter 19. So these are long ago, right? Long ago. And he's using these examples. And why is he doing it? Why did he reduce? Why did he not spare angels who sinned? Why did he destroy the world then? And why is it that he reduced Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes? As an example, verse 6, to those who would live ungodly lives thereafter. Look, that's you and me, right? If we choose to live that way. If we're in Christ, we're not living that way. But, and if you're taking notes, write down Jude 5. Also write down 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Because in those passages, we get more examples of what God does to those who live ungodly. You remember the group that he took out of Egyptian bondage, right? That's the point that Jude makes, and that's what's also seen in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. They came out protected by God, but then they decided to follow other ways, everything except God, and they died in the wilderness, right? That's the point. And so understand this. He did these things as an example. And now, after several thousand years of these happening, these false teachers are being warned, and brethren are being warned, that this is what's going to happen to them. They're going to be destroyed. Notice down in verse 12. But these, that is the false teachers, like unreasoning animals born as creatures of instinct to be captured and killed, reviling where they have no knowledge, will in the destruction of those creatures also be destroyed. Okay? And so, there's some trouble for the false teacher. Look at verse 17. These, false teachers again, are springs without water, mist driven by a storm, for whom the black darkness has been reserved. Jude says, for whom the blackness of darkness has been reserved forever. This is the end for the false teacher. This is what's going to happen to the false teacher. And as we made reference earlier in verses 20 through 22, I'll not go back and read those, but we're talking about these who have escaped the defilements of the world. Peter says that they're worse off after they have obeyed and then gone back into the world than had they never, ever obeyed at all. Right? The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. That's the language he uses. So, what can we say about the false teachers? Are they going to get away with it? No. Punishment's coming. Punishment, in fact, is certain. They're not going to get away with it. Well, that's great. But what about us? How are we going to, how do we fare? And what's God doing for us? Well, we've already noticed, of course, what he's done in chapter 1. We're partakers of the divine nature, right? But notice, mixed in with this pronouncement of judgment, notice what he says back in verses 4 and following again. Let's start with, not verse 4, we got judgment there on angels. Okay, verse 5, he did not spare the ancient world, but notice this, he preserved Noah, a preacher of righteousness, who with seven others, he delivered him. Then, when you get down to verse 7, you remember the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, but if he rescued righteous Lot, oppressed by the people who live there, then notice what he says in verse 9. Then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from temptation. Right? That's you and me. So God delivered Noah. God delivered Lot. And God's going to deliver us. He will deliver us. And that's a great blessing to think about. Now, Since this is the case, what do we need to do? Well, we reflect back on verses 5 through 7 in chapter 1. We've got to persevere. That means endurance. That means we need to know, if we didn't know already, you have to deal with these rascals until time comes to an end, right? I want to know this. Not only is it the case that I know that they're going to be punished, and that's for certain, and I know that he can deliver me, but when's that going to happen? When's that going to take place? I want you to notice a few terms that Peter uses. First of all, we go back, we talk about punishment. Verse 4 of chapter 2, I've got these highlighted in my Bible. You might write them down as well. Verse 4, that these false teachers are reserved for judgment, right? When you get down to verse 9, we actually have it changed a little bit. They're going to be punished on the day of judgment. All right? So make note of the day of judgment. And if you're looking, making notes with the book of Jude, you might write down Jude 24. And we skip over to chapter 3 and verse 4. Where is the promise of his coming? Now understand this. These are the false teachers that are mocking. They ask the question, where is the promise of his coming? You see what's happening? They know the teaching of the second coming of Christ. But they're so bold that they're making fun of it and mocking and saying, it ain't going to happen. Well, these same fellows have had a rude awakening since that time. And any who follow in their shoes will as well. But we notice in verse 7, the present heavens and earth are being reserved for fire, kept for the day of judgment and destruction. And so again, we have the day of judgment. We have the day of destruction. Notice verse 10. The day of the Lord will come like a thief. And so this same day of judgment is also called the day of the Lord. In verse 12, notice this. Looking for and hastening the coming of the day of God. It's called the day of God here. And so, what are we talking about? And I'm being elusive somewhat on purpose. We're talking about a day that is reserved. Remember back to verse 4, when we think about reserved, think about it just the way you would reservations at a restaurant. There's a day reserved for judgment. Okay? Take it to the bank. The day's coming. And so, as we think about this day of judgment, right? We understand that the time is coming. Now, when is that time coming? Again, I purposely left out details because what I'd like for us to do over the next 2 or 3 weeks is sort of a segue into talking about, let's spend some time talking about Judgment Day. And let's spend some time talking about the end of time. Can we know when it is? Can we know what it's going to look like? You know? I would love to say that I can give you all the answers and you'll leave completely satisfied, but I know better than that. But what we will do, okay, let's take a look and see what the Bible says about Judgment Day and what the Bible says about what happens after Judgment Day. We know that part of what happens on Judgment Day is that these false teachers and the ungodly, they're going to be punished. Where will they be punished? How will they be punished? How long will the punishment last? Will it be once and over? Will it be eternal? Let's take a look at that over the next few weeks, okay? So we'll look at how we should live, or if it even matters how we live, right? And it does. Spoiler alert on that one, right? But we'll look at that over the next several weeks. Now, as we close out, what I want us to note is some words that you're going to hear me say over the next few weeks, okay? This day of judgment and destruction coming for the false teacher, but it's also a day of judgment for you and me. There's going to come a final day, right? When time comes to an end. And since time is going to come to an end, this is what Peter says, and again, these are words I'm going to repeat to you over the next few weeks because I want you to think about this and make it part of who we are. We need to make it part of our character. Peter says this, since all these things are to be destroyed in this way, what sort of people are you to be in holy conduct and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming of the day of the Lord? Okay? And at the end he says in verse 17, you therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand or being forewarned, be on your guard so that you aren't carried away by the error of unprincipled men and fall from your own steadfastness or fall from your own secure position, right? But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's going to come a day when time's going to come to an end and we give an answer. We'll look at that over the next few weeks. But right now, let's make sure that if you are not in Christ and you want to be in Christ, understand we're glad to teach you the book. And it will take as long as we need to teach you. If you got questions about it, we want to help you. We're going to going to sing an invitation song here in just a minute. Charlie's going to lead us in one. And if you have questions about obeying the gospel, stop one of us. We're glad to help you. If you are a member of the body of Christ and you have fallen away, don't find yourself in the same position as these false teachers. You know, if you've tasted the glory of God, but you've gone back into the world, look, let's repent. The Lord wants you to repent. The Lord wants you to be in heaven. And we want to help you do that as well. If you have a need, won't you come down while we stand and while we sing?